Good morning, everybody. My name is Samia, Rahman, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Muslim Institute. I would like to thank you all for coming here today and giving up your precious bank holiday Saturday to discuss with us the spiritual crisis of our times. So what does that mean exactly? I suppose I'm reminded of the words of the late great Prince when he said, "Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to get through this thing called life." Perhaps for many of us, life is an ongoing sort of spiritual crisis. I'm not sure. What does it mean to be spiritual, and what does it mean to be in spiritual crisis? What I am sure about, however, is that when we talk about being spiritual, we're more often than not talking about a very secular Western concept that often conjures up notions of New Age, pseudo-Eastern appropriation. Spiritual but not religious is a label that many proudly bear, but what about being spiritual and religious? So I hope that today's conference will go some way towards problematizing the dominant narrative that Muslims have a monopoly on the crisis of spirituality of our times. In a world increasingly marked by apathy and rampant consumerism and extremism, here today the Muslim Institute asks whether the once thriving influence of spirituality that still exists in Muslim communities can be restored, and explore whether the reclamation of the spiritual heart of Islam can not only regenerate such communities from within, but also play a part in enabling wider society to recover its own soul. So these are conversations that need to take place in a safe space. And it's my hope that here today, because we at the Muslim Institute celebrate and cherish critical thinking, that we will have those important conversations. So let me begin by introducing the question that will preoccupy the conference's opening session, which is whose spiritual crisis? So to start the discussion, I would like to introduce our first speaker, Farouk, Peru. Farouk describes himself as a novice academic whose interests include the study of Quran, according to its author. He's also an Islamicist who focuses on Islam as a world culture, Islamofascism, which is the study of the system of oppression within Islam, and Quranist Islam, the study of how Muslims are bypassing tradition in favor of direct connectivity with the Quran. He's also interested in philosophy, where he hopes to build on Heidegger's philosophy of being as the basis of all philosophical thought. So over to you, Farouk.
Thank you. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Fala uqsimu bishafaq. So I call to witness the ruddy glow of sunset. Wal layli wa ma wasaq. And the sun and its homing. Wal qamari idha tasaq. And the moon in her fullness. La tarkabunna tabaqan an tabaq. That you will surely travel from stage to stage. Fama lahum la yu'minun. And what is the matter with them that they do not believe? وَإِذَا كُورِيَ عَلَيْهِمُ الْقُرْآنِ لَا يَسْجُدُونَ. And when the Quran is recited on them, they do not submit. I chose this passage as an opening because this is the unique place in the Quran where Allah mentions لَتَرْكَبُنَّ طَبَقًا أَن طَبَقًا, where you will move from stage to stage. In my understanding, this is referring to the travel of the soul in its evolution. And I believe that this is the central underpinning of the Quran, that we are here for the evolution of our souls. Indeed, in another verse, chapter 59, verse 19, Allah says, "And be not like those who forgot about Allah, and Allah made them forget their own souls." So the relationship between Allah and the soul is inextricable. For us to forget about Allah, or, you know, we're not talking about the tribal God Allah here, we're talking about the concept of the divine. What will happen is that we will forget about the evolution of ourselves, our personalities. Hence, we will not travel beyond the stage of death. Hence, we will end up in what is traditionally known as hell. And to me, that is the purpose of spirituality. Spirituality has a set purpose, and that purpose must be met in order for us to actually gain benefit from it. Now, apologies, I'll be looking at my phone here. I'm not actually tweeting anything. I am just trying to read from my notes because I was a bit late in preparing them. So every Sunday, about 100 to 150 homeless people, they gather at the Red Lion Square in Holborn. And they are given food, drink, blankets, etc. You know? And the people who do their distribution are, and I've done a count on this, not more than 15 to 20 Muslims. And we're talking mostly Muslims who are from their late teens to late 20s. So, I mean, when I first chanced upon this activity, and it's been going on for 2-3 years now, I was deeply impressed. I mean, these people did not need any kind of government sponsorship. They did not need a major Islamic organization. They simply got together among themselves. They found people to contribute food and drink and what have you. And by themselves, they have a running operation. There is no central, I mean, there are central organizers, but no one person dominates the show. If one person fails to make it, another person will take over, etc. I mean, this is the kind of organization corporations can only dream of, because it's run on faith. And I look at the number, right? And the number is, as I said, 15 to 20, 20 at the most. And I compare this with the East London Mosque on Fridays. I reckon at least 1,000 people turn up for Jummah. And when I compare that number, 20 to 1,000, that's 2%. 2% of people turn up on Sunday evenings to do what Islam demands. Compared, 2% of people, yeah, compared to the 98% who only turn up for rituals. That, to me, is the spiritual crisis of the Muslims. So this term, spiritual, it is not an easy term to pin down. I mean, I've seen spiritual used in a number of ways, you know, and as Samia said, you know, spiritual but not religious. I can see how that would work. And, you know, some people say, well, this is a very spiritual experience, referring to jumping off cliffs or, I don't know, doing bungee jumping. You know, some people call that spiritual. I for one, fail to see that, but, you know, I don't own language. Language is a democracy. But to me, spiritual has a dual connotation based on its dynamic. Spiritual, to me, is the opposite of religious and the opposite of materialistic. So the spiritual is something which can only be born when the other two are on the decline. Please allow me to explain. Islam is classified as a religion. And how we know this is on the census. If someone asks you what your religion is, Islam is one of the tick boxes. Or if you go to Waterstones, you will not find the books on Islam in the philosophy section. Even if the book is on Islamic philosophy, you will find it in the religious section. So Islam is most decidedly a religion. So why am I saying that spirituality is the opposite of religion? Well, because I'm using the term religion in a more descriptive sense rather than a more conventional sense. A religion to me is something which is institution-based. It has its set dogma. In the case of what I call traditional Islam, it's centralized on the dogma of the five pillars of religion and the six pillars of faith. It has various practices which define a Muslim. Now, anyone here who is a revert would automatically know that, okay, once you become a Muslim, they will put you through a certain process to educate you about the basics of the religion, right? And this education is hardly ever about activism. In fact, I've never met a revert who said, well, my Islamic education means that I had to travel to the third world and see how poor people live and how to help them, etc. That's not what a reversion is about. A reversion in the conventional sense is essentially how to do religious performances. And that, to me, is a signifier of religion. Religion is a space outside the dunya, as they call it, or the world. And that space is where you are attaining some measure of piety. Now, is that necessarily spiritual? I do not think so. I think it can be spiritual if we understand it in the right way. Otherwise, it becomes a social practice. Case in point, I don't know if any of you have been to the mosque, in recent years. When I go to certain mosques and I don't pray in a certain way, I get told off. Not told off, but at least someone will come to me and say, excuse me, brother, you're not praying in the right way. You know, if you do that, you won't get real thawab from Allah, etc. So this, to me, is a mark that, in fact, Islam is a religion rather than a spiritual path. So that's one, religion. The second thing spirituality is opposite to is materialism. Materialism is not entirely divorced from religion. How I see it working is, when something is materialistic, it enables you to use religion as a means of ticking the box. Case in point, let's say, you know, when it's World Cup season. I mean, my dad and brothers are very big fans, football fans. But my dad, he doesn't miss his prayers. And I remember during, I think, World Cup 2012, I happened to be back home during that time. And my dad was like, look, I need to go and quickly pray. I said, well, why do you need to go and quickly pray? Well, you know, the game is about to start. So I said, okay, well, why don't you just pray later on when you're like feeling up to it? No. If you miss the prayers, you get a certain minus points. But if you pray on time, you get some plus points. Now, when I was doing this, I just thought to myself, this is the earmark of religion. Religion puts you in that do and you get reward, don't and you don't get reward category. No matter what your mentality is, when you perform it, that's fine, as long as you can return to the material world unscathed, as it were. So that's why Islam ultimately became a religion. And when you think about it, during the time of Islam's inception, I don't mean in the earliest times, in the time of Noah, but the final manifestation of Islam as we understand it with Muhammad, what happened was that the beginning stage of Islam was all about spiritual people. I mean, these people, if you read the Quran about them, Allah calls them radiyallahu anhum. Radiyallahu anhum. The pleasure, good pleasure of Allah is upon them. And why is that the case? I mean, you know, radiyallahu anhum is not anyone, you know, it's just these people. And it's because these people attained that level of spirituality, so much so that their materialistic concerns were at an absolute minimum. In fact, that ayah, that is chapter 9, verse 100, it calls them as-sabiquna awwalin, or the foremost of the early ones. And Allah calls them, describes them as al-muhajirin, not al-muhajirun, the group. This is al-muhajirin. And these people, they sacrificed their homes and moved to an unknown area. And Allah also calls them Al-Ansar, these people who are helping the immigrants. Now, can you imagine people who open up their homes and allow you to emigrate? Now, that takes a level of belief which I can't even imagine. I mean, I wouldn't do that. I'll be honest with you, I don't think I can do that. But these people did it. And they did this because their level of materialism was very low. They did not care for the materialism of this world. They much preferred the spirit, the true spirituality, which I believe is what Allah calls qurb, or closeness with Allah. Indeed, Allah in the Quran, Allah gives three categories of people. One is the Ashabul Mash'amah, which are the people of the left. These are the people who did everything wrong. And then you have the Ashabul Maimana, the people of the right. They are those who did things right. And to me, this is religious performances. They did things right. But there is another level of people called the Muqarribin, the people who are close with the divine. Now, how did they attain this closeness? And if we wish to understand it, we should look at the Sunnah of Isa in the Quran, Jesus in the Quran. Because Jesus is the only one in the Quran called a Muqarrib. The only personality called a Muqarrib. No other personality is called that. And the angels are also called Muqarribin. So you can imagine, angels, Jesus, and that is the level which you are meant to attain in spiritual terms. So the question is, are Muslims in a spiritual crisis? I would say, is anyone not in a spiritual crisis? You know, I look at the world and I fail to imagine in this day of virtual realities, you know, and social media, where you can see, take for example, the issue of animal welfare. Animal welfare really, really depresses me. I wouldn't go so far as to advocate veganism 100%, right? But I would say that the way we treat animals is just a testament to our materialistic concerns and how we use religion as a means of bridging that ethical gap, as it were. Now, if you've seen these videos, the latest is the Yulin Dog Festival in China. And I must say, that depressed me to no end. I can still close my eyes and visualize that. It was just so horrid. Well, some people say, well, that's your cultural conditioning. Could be. But what really baffles me is that we lack compassion to that extent where we can actually use our culture and our religions to justify it. Zia, who's not here at the moment, would probably mention the chicken and chips industry. Chicken and chips is definitely halal because, you know, you play the bismillah while you're doing the slaughter. But the suffering which is incurred during this heinous activity can only be legitimized with religion without spirit. You are adhering to the letter of the law, but you are purposely neglecting the spiritual aspect. That's the only way you can justify something like this. And that is the case with the world, I must say. I think the world refuses to have that compassionate element about them, which is the mark of spirituality. And they are focusing on these legal minutiae in order for them to say, okay, well, you know what? At least now they are not battery farmed anymore. They are not caged, so they can really travel within that little box which they are living. Instead of being like that, they have that. Oh, that's justifying. That is indeed the spirituality versus religion element, I think. So what can we do? What can we do to re-inject spirituality back into our lives? To me, the first thing is we must stop becoming religious consumers. And this doesn't mean that we need to reject everything which has been passed down to us. I'm a Quranist, and we Quranists tend to be quite radical in this step. You know, we tend to anything traditional is bad, which is not true. There are useful things within the tradition. But we must never forgo the process of questioning. We must always ask, why do we do things that way? For example, the halal slaughter, is it the most humane way of killing the animal? If there's a more humane way, why not use it? I mean, if it at least minimizes suffering. So I think everyone needs to construct his or her own personal Islam. That's the name of my blog, by the way. If you just Google that, you will see my writings there. Everyone must read the Quran for him or herself. Now, this is a Quranist philosophy, by the way. We Quranists believe that we can only come to our understanding of the Quran, and the only way for us to deepen that understanding is to have an unfettered conversation. We cannot be afraid of anything. I mean, there are people who actually lose faith, you know, when they read too much into something, they say, well, I don't believe anymore. But we cannot be afraid of that, because the alternative is worse, which is blind faith. We don't want blind faith. Everyone must adopt a cause for himself. It's not enough to be religious. I don't believe that's what God wants. I believe what God wants is to bring Ihsan to the world. Ihsan is the manifestation of God's attributes into the world. And I believe that causes, animal welfare, that's a cause. Taking care of refugees, that's a cause. Reforming education, that's a cause. So everyone must adopt a cause for himself. We have to lose the idea of religious shortcuts. Religious shortcuts, I mean, I'm sure you all must know if you subscribe to Islamic channels. You know, they tell you, okay, now is the month of Rajab. If you say certain religious formulae during these times, the angels will descend upon you and bless you till judgment day and so on and so forth. This, I'm sorry to say, this is all bunkum, really. If you want to attain salvation, there is no other way except for spiritual evolution. And spiritual evolution can only work by functioning in the world. Fasting. This is the last solution I can offer. Fasting. Fasting is something which I, obviously, if you look at my physical body, I came to it very late. But I see the value of fasting now. I see it's like, you know, when your soul is expecting a huge meal. I mean, I was expecting a huge lunch today, but I would have to be let down by that. Fasting helps you to sort of like bring your soul under control, I think. When you are able to say no, or, you know, instead of taking two portions of rice, take one portion, something which has plagued me all my life, that helps. That helps bring you closer to the divine. And I don't believe that this is necessarily a religious act. I believe that this is something which is very existential. It really has to do with our being, because we are consumer-oriented being. We want to consume at all times. When we stop the flow of consumption, I think that opens the door upwards to the divine. And that to me is a very easy and immediate way of attaining that closeness. Right, thank you very much for listening.
Thank you, Farouk. I should have mentioned at the beginning, actually, that there are biscuits and coffee in the kitchen, so we have been attempting to, you know, feed your being and your soul to some extent. And I do apologise about lunch. We haven't put on lunch. I'm now going to move on to Fatimah Ashrif. Now, I'll introduce Fatima by saying that she studied theology and religious studies at Cambridge University and holds a master's in human rights from the University of Manchester. Her dissertation was on the compatibility of Islam and human rights. She's on the Northwest Regional Board of the charity Mosaic and is a founding member of Rumi's Circle. In a previous life, she works as a lawyer. But in her current life, she's an advisor to a group of family trusts on philanthropic and charity projects. Over to you. Samia.
Bismillah. Begin in the name of Allah, the infinitely compassionate and the infinitely merciful. How is my voice? Is it carrying?
Could be louder.
Could be louder, okay. So, Bismillah. Is that better? In the name of Allah, the infinitely compassionate and the infinitely merciful, I want to begin by saying that I'm very hopeful about the situation we find ourselves in as a community and as human beings. This is because I do believe that Islam and other spiritual traditions do possess the raw ingredients of what is required to meet the challenges of our time. These challenges present us with an opportunity to engage in honest self-examination and bring to light any need for reorientation to the authentic principles of our faiths. I have noticed a responsiveness in the Muslim community space here in the UK and abroad and outside of that space in non-Muslim communities with people thinking and working creatively together. Within the UK Muslim community space, I'm really grateful to the Muslim Institute for creating a safe space for critical thinking and sharing of ideas, and for the work of the newly formed New Horizons, which is focused on creating conversation around what can sometimes seem to be contentious issues. The work of the Inclusive Mosque Initiative and others in pushing the conversations around inclusivity, and the work of the Threshold Society, which is in different ways providing a space for those reflective and critical thinkers who are interested in spirituality for our times. Though I couldn't be very scientific and think about indicators that suggest that there is a clear crisis in spirituality amongst Muslims and other faiths, I just think it's kind of evident that, you know, that there's clearly something that's not right in the current landscape as we look around. So and thinking of the Muslim context, I think it is clear that amongst certain Muslims that there is an obsession with ritual conformism and outward piety. There can also be the accompanying prevalence of legalism, selective literalism, parochialism, dogma, and tribalism. And these can and do have damaging and divisive consequences. And such preoccupations have existed throughout Islamic history to varying degrees, but perhaps more so at the present time due to various factors. Indeed, many of the spiritually inclined figures throughout Islamic history and to the present day have critiqued the preoccupation with unthinking conformism and outward piety through poetry and teaching stories. I'm reminded of the lyrics of Nusrat Fateh Ali Khan Qawwali, one of my favorites, in which he sings, "Na namaz aati hai mujhko na wuzu." I do not know how to perform the ritual prayer, and I do not know how to perform my ablutions. Sajda kar leta hoon jab samne tu aata hai. I simply go down in prostration when you appear before me. The point being that he doesn't know the finer points of law, but yet God actually appears to him. This critique has always been popular with certain Muslims, and perhaps goes to the heart of the matter, and that is that true spirituality is communion with the divine, and it cannot be attained through prescriptive piety, but that love is needed. I would define spirituality as a connection with something we deem sacred, so that may be God or nature or our own higher consciousness, depending on our beliefs. And being spiritual is about integrating that spirituality into one's life, that is nourishing a connection or an awareness of the sacred, so that might be God consciousness in theistic terms, and living a compassionate life which is based in that consciousness and connectedness. In current times, in day-to-day life, there is a huge disconnect with the sacred. Many of us live in cities, busy lives, many distractions, through the constant pinging of our amazing handheld devices. Human life, relationships, nature, ethics appear to be undervalued and in danger. We can be largely reactive and driven by our own fear stories. It is not clear that we actually even truly listen to each other or actually really see each other as human beings. It is a time of real difficulty due to the overlap and interplay of many different conflicting factors pushing and pulling us in all sorts of directions, and things are rarely as they seem. But this should not prevent us from seeing this as an opportunity for all persons to go back to basic principles, to cultivate their connection with the sacred, and from that strong grounding, serve their local communities and wider society. Thinking specifically about the Islamic context, Muslims have much to contribute to British society and beyond, provided that we are willing to progress beyond a narrow focus on legal rulings and embody the finest elements of the Islamic tradition, its rich and diverse cultural and artistic heritage, its respect for learning and critical inquiry, its moral compass, its spiritual depth and vision of a fair and just society. And with this in mind, I want to just mention four areas which I think as Muslims we could bring more attention to, and there will be a little bit of overlap with what my friend Farouk has also shared. So, but firstly, I would say I think that there is clearly a need to nurture a culture of compassion. On a visit to Sarajevo last year, I was speaking with our guide, who was a defender of that city in the siege from 1992 to 1996. And I kind of started asking him about the Mufti of Bosnia. And for those who don't know, Bosnia has a single Mufti who is in charge of all the mosques in Bosnia. Now, imagine that. Not that I would condone a similar model for Britain or that we could ever have that, but that's what they have. And the guide praised him hugely. What our guide really liked about him was his flexibility about religious observance. The Mufti had said to him that he valued much more someone who did not pray a single prayer and was a good human being than someone who simply prayed and was unkind to those around him. Our guide had been through war. He no longer really described himself as a Muslim, but as an other, having experienced firsthand the divide that religion can be used to cause. This exchange reminded me of the hadiths of the Prophet, which suggests that God may forgive non-compliance with what are known as hukuk al-Allah, the rights of God, but will not forgive non-compliance with hukuk al-Ibad, the rights of creation. This confirms that for the divine, the key thing is how we treat other human beings and the rest of creation. This brings me to the Prophet's way, which was one of flexibility and compassion. The Quran says of the Prophet, "We sent thee not save as a mercy to the worlds." And his wife Aisha affirms that the Prophet's character was that of the Quran. And as one turns to each surah of the Quran, all but one begin with how I began, which is, "In the name of God, the infinitely compassionate and infinite mercy. So the qualities of mercy and compassion are really important. And they're illustrated well in a couple of hadith that I will share. So Abu Huraira reported that the Prophet said that forgiveness was granted to a prostitute who came upon a dog panting and almost dead from thirst at the mouth of a well. She took off her shoe and tied it with her head covering and drew some water for it. And on that account, she was forgiven. And Aisha reported that, Aisha, the Prophet's wife, reported that he said, "Avoid the affliction of prescribed penalties on Muslims as much as you can. And if there is a way out, let a man go. For it is better for a leader to make a mistake in forgiving than to make a mistake in punishing." And you know, these are just a couple of many sort of traditions which narrate the mercy and flexibility, you know, inbuilt in Islam and the Prophet's approach. And I feel that we individually need to embody this urgently. Secondly, there's the need to nourish the spirit of inquiry. When it comes to religious and spiritual matters, you know, the ultimate knowledge, we find ourselves placing sometimes complete and total authority with scholars, imams, and muftis, sometimes even with those with whom we have no direct sort of personal relationship. Perhaps we just happen to like their YouTube videos or sound bites on social media. And though we might criticize the local mullah in the mosque who may hail from a village in Pakistan, if a scholar dresses in a particular way and speaks English in a particular way, we may believe in the soundness of what he's saying without question. I'm not saying that scholars should not be trusted, but that one should have the ability to discern for themselves and know what makes sense for one's own heart and engage oneself also in the act of seeking knowledge and decision making and taking ownership. There is a hadith of the Prophet in which he encourages individuals to actively consult their own hearts. There are presently issues around the ability of, questions around the ability of whether imams and scholars trained in the traditional way can relate to the British or European context. context, and the lack of criticality employed in the teaching of Islamic sciences has also been highlighted. And there are some organizations looking at developing contextualized, holistic, and reflective training for imams and scholars, but there's still a way to go. There also appears to be a gap in scholarship of many hundreds of years where no new thought appears to have been developed. And then there is a lack of sufficient female scholars, which is also an issue. And this is important as there is certain inclusivity that the feminine experience and insight brings to the table. My intention here is not to undermine scholars who spent years acquiring knowledge of the Islamic sciences, but to suggest that the systems are not perfect and neither are the scholars. They deserve respect, perhaps, but ought not to be deemed infallible. In this age of ease of access to so much material, there is a possibility of deep study for any sincere seeker, and this should be encouraged, and the seeker should seek to be well-rounded in his or her knowledge. Most of us know that historically Islamic tradition encourages this process of discovery and critical inquiry, and so it's disturbing that we don't continue in that vein to encourage it. There is more than one kind of knowledge recognized in the tradition, with the highest form being the knowledge of the sacred and our relationship to it. This knowledge is to be found in the Quran and science and the heart. And of course, Islamic civilization has always placed a high value on scientific knowledge and indeed became a preserver of knowledge from other great civilizations. And then there are many Quranic verses and hadith which big up the seeking of knowledge. And I was going to quote a few, but because I'm short on time, I'm just going to skip them. They are there, and I'm sure you can find them. And it's amazing how much the status of a learner is really glorified, actually, that it is above that of a pious person, actually. So I feel that, as Farouk mentioned, that we should not be afraid of engaging directly with the Quran. It invites the individual to reflect themselves and the signs in the world around them and in themselves. The Quran is a wonderful teacher, using stories and metaphor to activate our imagination and to teach us about reality. Make note that it's not a rule book. If we do not encourage the spirit of inquiry, and importantly critical and reflective inquiry, it is possible that Islam will seem irrelevant to the modern world. This would be sad, actually, because Islam has much to offer any human heart. Thirdly, there is a need for us to cultivate knowledge of the heart and connection with the sacred. This is crucial to a holistic education which is concerned with the whole range of human faculties and necessary to a true spirituality. In Sufi circles particularly, there is an emphasis on the heart as a subconscious or superconscious faculty of the mind through which the sacred is made intelligible. It is also deemed the midpoint between the self or the nafs and the spirit or ruh. In Sufi psychology, the idea is that a heart made pure by spiritual practice can guide the usually self-serving nafs, ego, to a true connection with spirit. The stronger the connection to spirit, the stronger the capacity to serve selflessly and not be slaves to our ego's whims and desires. The Quran tells us that the heart finds rest in the remembrance of God. The purpose of spiritual practice is to nourish that connection with the sacred. From my own experience, I personally could not connect or find any peace in Salat, in the ritual prayer as I was growing up. It didn't feel authentic to me, and I found the postures, frankly, to be a bit distracting. And so I chose instead to sit in the lotus position and chant the names of God, which I learned from Buddhism. Well, actually, I guess it is just a form of zikr. And this was really beneficial at that time. And it's something that has changed too. I mean, though I continue with zikr type practices, I also do now connect to the ritual prayer. I feel, however, that meditation practices have helped to develop a greater sense of connectivity in my ritual prayer. I also appreciate now that the purpose of submitting to a spiritual practice is about increasing our will so that actually it truly is a free will and our intentionality, and to provide ourselves excuses in the day so that we can go and converse for 5 minutes with the lovely one and say, hey, how's it going, you know, and just have that connectivity, and to follow the rhythms of the day to ground us in nature and to undertake postures which remind us of our relationship with the sacred. And so really now that I understand that and I feel that, you know, it really works for me. I've had that similar experience of praying in the mosque and being told that my feet were not in the right position or my hair wasn't completely covered. And you know, that's always quite disturbing. I feel that any spiritual practice should move us or connect us in some way to the sacred. And anything that does that is spiritual practice in my book. As I mentioned, spiritual practice has the capacity also to develop our own will. In a world where we are constantly in reactive mode, it's really important to exercise our free will, to choose not to be reactive, to choose to be what the moment needs us to be. For example, meditative and contemplative practices can help us to an awareness, a witnessing of ourselves and the way our minds work, the way we operate. Zikr can help us develop a sense of presence. And by presence, a huge topic in itself, I mean a consciousness of ourselves, our present situation, and our connection to the sacred all at once in any given moment. This can help create moments and spaces between the stimuli and our reactions to them. So just to use a very simple example, if we are out and about and somebody says something abusive towards us, rather than responding disproportionately and possibly losing our temper, we may instead pause and choose to let it pass. The more conscious choices we make to do or not do something, the more our free will is strengthened. If we can attempt to cultivate this moment-by-moment awareness of the sacred, we begin to truly integrate spirituality into our lives, and we begin to live from a place of higher consciousness. The more we can integrate this sacred awareness into our lives, the more things start to open up and the more creativity seems to flow. This is what is required, a continual evolution of our consciousness. I'll just skip a paragraph, I think, or two, because I would like to kind of... So I was going to talk about the fact that, you know, that the Sufi tradition has given us a lot. It has helped Islam to spread. It has resulted in creative flourishing. If we are concerned about certain elements of it, we should not write off the whole tradition because of what it has given to Islam in terms of the figures, the creativity, and in terms of it sort of really making us seek connection with the divine, which can often be missing from purely intellectual inquiry. And so this actually then takes me to the final point. So the combination, I can skip that too, sorry. So fourthly, there is a need to cultivate an attitude of service. And this is, for me, connected to it's connected to what Farouk was saying about Ihsan and activism, actually. So not only toward the Muslim community, but towards all community and our whole society. Human beings are God's Khalifa, the servants of the divine, here to serve God's entire creation and to take care of it, and not simply this generation, but future generations too. When we stand in prayer with our hands crossed over our navel, this is a reminder of our status before God as his or her representative on this earth. Every issue that oppresses humanity, animals, and the earth at this moment should be our concern. Embodying the example of the Prophet and the other noble individuals, cultivating our heart and head knowledge and self-awareness and God consciousness should lead us to a place where we can heartfully and compassionately serve our communities. We should be involved in social action projects, big and small, fight to keep our local libraries, volunteer in hospitals. We should protest against fracking, the appalling practices of the meat and dairy industry, campaign against unfair economic practices, campaign for human rights, expose the truth, work with those of other and no faith to recognize shared values and create harmonious communities, just as, and some are already doing this. The Khalifa must do beauty because, as the Hadith Qudsi says, God is beautiful and loves the beautiful. And true beauty draws us and others into relationship with the divine. I think what we have to remember is that on a human level, a lot of the challenges that we face are driven by fear. And unfortunately, this results in a desire for absolutes. It can stifle creativity, imagination, and flexibility. I suggest we take the beauty of our tradition, the spirit of inquiry and seeking, the means for developing sacred connection, and join with those of other faiths, asking them to bring forth the best of their own tradition and combining it with the technological advances of our time, and a heaping handful of love-inspiring beauty, and use it to think up the solutions for the problem humanity currently faces. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you very much, Fatimah, and thank you for allowing me to sort of speed you along. Very gracious. So I'm now going to turn to Rishi Handa, who's going to offer a sort of slightly different perspective. I'll just introduce Rishi. Rishi studied mathematics with theoretical physics as an undergrad before completing an MA at SOAS in South Asian Area Studies. He majored in Hindu jurisprudence. He then went on to complete a PhD, also at SOAS, on the construction of religious identities in the Punjab. His academic research interests include world mysticism, Sikh studies, Indian philosophy, and continental philosophy. Over to you, Rishi.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now, I'm coming at this from a slightly different approach because, unlike my friends here who have just spoken before me, I'm not an insider in the tradition. Yet I'm not I'm not fully an outsider either, because over the years my connectivity with Sufism, at a personal spiritual level, has allowed me to gain a certain insight. So I think I can provide two angles, the outsider and the insider angle, in some ways. Now, what I feel is that at the moment, I mean, I've titled this a suggestive interpretative approach. The angle I'm going with is that perhaps there's a new approach that's needed in looking at Islam. Something that will allow it to deal with what I see as crises that it's facing. Extremist views. Okay, so it's not a hidden thing, of course. In the eyes of the world, the appearance of Islam is such, well, certain aspects of it, that there are militant areas. There are militant facets, and some will attribute it to the Quran. Now, the Quran itself is open to interpretation, of course, and you get some elements from the Muslim community. I remember a documentary a few years ago on TV where some elements of the Muslim community were justifying views that the militant elements would take as being in the Quran. Then you've got the Sufi Council saying, no, we don't support those sorts of views, they're not legitimate, and they cite verses like there's no compulsion in religion. Now, we obviously have issues here of hermeneutics, rules of interpretation, they're coming from different perspectives. One has to look at history in order to get a better sense of what are the appropriate, what are the more justified rules of interpretation to look at a text. Unfortunately, we get ourselves stuck in a little hermeneutic circle because if we want to understand history, we've got to rely on a certain mindset. And that mindset shapes our view of history. On the flip side, it's our interpretation of history that shapes the way we look at the philosophical aspect or the interpretation of the text. So we get ourselves a little bit caught up. We also find that there's a struggle between reason and faith. And I put a picture up of Sam Harris. Well, actually, before I talk about Sam Harris, because he's quite an important character in this day and age. How do we understand faith? I mean, it's such a broad term. I see two types. I see faith being understood as there being two types of faith. One is, if I say I've got a student, and I look at, I'm a school teacher, so I'll use the example. I've got a student, and I look at their past experiences of in terms of how they approach their studies, and I say to the child, I've got faith that you'll get an A. Or I don't have faith you'll get an A. Now, that's based on my inductive experience. That's where I think it's appropriate. But that's not rooted in nothing. It's rooted in, there's some sort of reason going on there. There's some sort of experience going on there. But when we talk about faith with regard to the past or stuff which is extrasensory, and it flies in the face of evidence, the information that is, that's where it becomes a little worrying. So Bertrand Russell comes to mind. We might maybe define faith as a firm belief in something for which there is no evidence. Where there is evidence, no one speaks of faith. We do not speak of faith that two and two are four, or that the earth is round. We only speak of faith when we wish to substitute emotion for evidence. The substitution of emotion for evidence is apt to lead to strife, since different groups substitute different emotions. Now, Sam Harris is important because he's probably the predominant rationalist thinker of this day and age. But he's a very special character, in my eyes. Because he's unlike his friends Richard Dawkins and the late Christopher Hitchens. Hardcore rationalists, but didn't give any room to anything at a deeper level of consciousness. This chap does. This is why I've got time for him. Now, one of the quotes he has is, he says in his book, The End of Faith. He's very critical of faith, as the title suggests. But I like this line. Tell a devout Christian that his wife is cheating on him, or that frozen yogurt can make a man invisible, and he is likely to require as much evidence as anyone else, and to be persuaded only to the extent that you can give it. Tell him that the book he keeps by his bed was written by an invisible deity who will punish him with fire for eternity if he fails to accept its every incredible claim about the universe, and he seems to require no evidence whatsoever. Okay, so there are issues that need to be addressed, because the world is going down a certain direction. And to be selective as to when to use reason, I don't think is not appropriate. Even spiritual matters, one can use reason and rationality. There are systems in place, and I hope to address those. And then we've got struggles with science and history. So in the modern age, people like to use scientific information to prove the validity of the Quran. And I remember having some students who I was discussing with, and you know, references come up to like the splitting of the atom or the oily red rose nebulous, and that they're referred to in the Quran. And so, well, then it's a case of thumbs up. Our text is true because science has proved it. Well, these are only recent things that have been discovered in science. So that means for about 1350 years, people didn't have a clue what those bits meant. So they would have given their own interpretations. But what's going to happen in the future is that other things will get discovered, and I'll say, no, it's actually, it means this. So what's happening there is that science is getting the upper hand, ultimately. It's becoming the yardstick, the datum. But not for all, though, of course, like these three gentlemen. The first chap, Sheikh Bandar al-Khaybari, who says that the Earth is stationary. Abdul Aziz Ibn Abdullah Ibn Baz, the Grand Mufti and General President for Scientific Research and Fatwa, who suggests the Earth is flat. And Iranian cleric, Iranian guys go for the Persian accent here, Hujjatul Salam Qazim Siddiqui, who says that scantily clad women cause earthquakes. Now, this doesn't obviously look good for the image of Islam. It's showing it as rather backward. I mean, these guys aren't really good representations. It's not unique, of course, to Islam, because other traditions have their own issues. I mean, we have the Flat Earth Society in the States, run by Christians. The whole thing that the Earth is spherical is a conspiracy by scientists to make us not believe in God. And then, you know, you've got Hindus who take creation myths, for example, their various stories as literal rather than symbolic. So that's the science aspect. The history aspect, well, I mean, we have issues. I mean, I stand on the outside when I say this, of course, that if we take a character like Adam, now, many would take him to be literal, a literal historical character. For those engaged in the Jews, engaged in Kabbalah, the mystical aspect, they don't treat Adam as literal. They treat it as symbolic of the primordial man and the state of the individual at that initial, on the initial part of their journey. Take someone like Jesus. Now, for about 100 odd years, there's been a talk about his lack of historicity, that there wasn't historical Jesus. Now, simply to dismiss it is to not engage in dialogue. And then one isn't going to take a community seriously if they're not going to engage in intellectual dialogue, not in this day and age. But for the Gnostics, of course, Jesus doesn't have to be historical for him to be true, and I'll mention that a little bit later. Now, Islam has had a great history of scientific discovery and research. Intellect is always encouraged, as you said before. But we don't get a lot of that necessarily now. Wahhabism, perhaps, encouraging that. In fact, some students of mine, back in 2008, I was asked by my colleagues to take over their lessons because they were being taught philosophy and ethics. And there were six students, it wasn't yours, yours was earlier. There were six students, all Muslims. And the reason why my colleagues were getting frustrated is because as they're engaging with dialogue about ethics, at least the teacher's trying to get them to engage in dialogue, there was no discussion. It was ultimately what the Quran says. And that's it. Well, these guys don't realize that actually Islam has had a great history of jurisprudence, of discussing things, trying to work out. It's not as clear cut as the Quran says. And I think it's their innocence, it's their cluelessness, because they're not actually engaged in deeper research about the history of Islam. And then we have an issue with language and meaning. So you've got one of my favorites here, Jacques Derrida. His idea of deconstruction, so difference, the spelling is correct, he invented that spelling. His mum actually told him off for not spelling correctly. And that he says that meaning is constructed in use. Okay, so you have binary pairs of words. They depend on each other for meaning. And meaning is also deferred. So if you take a dictionary, take a word, look at its meaning, get a word from that, look it up in the dictionary, get a word from that meaning, look it up. Ultimately, it just becomes self-referential. So these are relative systems. So then to say that a text is the absolute word of God and language is absolute, and Arabic is the absolute language, poses problems philosophically. And if one's not going to engage philosophically, then, well, in this day and age, again, that's not acceptable. And it kind of undermines authority. So, putting that aside, Okay, so I have to speed this up considerably. Tim Freak, a chap I met in 2002 after I started reading his books, and I've stayed in touch with him since. He's written about 30 books on mysticism. He's gone through various different traditions and come out with this essential core that the beginning of the inquiry is that life is a mystery. And it's through that that we realise that actually we don't know anything. Derrida kind of really, his stuff really hints to that. Now is actually all you know. What happens is we engage ourselves in the realm of the mind, we engage ourselves in the past and in the future, and we treat them as real, but the past and future aren't real. The only thing that's real is the now. The past and future are only concepts in the mind. They're merely thoughts. But what we do is we live there, and we fail to live in the present. Now, the present's a very interesting place to be, because that's the realm of no mind, when you can transcend the mind. Now, I can't go into that this deep enough, obviously, because of lack of time. And what we find is that this lovely idea that you're not a person. So everybody is so caught up in this idea that I'm a person, this ego thing. But actually, you're not a person. Objectively, from the outside, yes, you are. But what's happening from your own experience, from the inside out? You are conscious of your body, you're conscious of your name, you're conscious of your voice. But what you are, speed it up, is the presence of awareness. From your subjective experience, forget what everybody else tells you you are. From your experience, you are the presence of awareness. And this is what all these masters around the world have been advocating. The logical thing that comes out of it is that ultimately all is one, and the real experience of oneness is to be in love, is love itself. Hate separates, love unifies. So absolute oneness, absolute love. From Tim, I came to know about this chap. I didn't unfortunately get to meet him because he died in 1980 and I was a little kid. but this has had a massive impact, and the clarity this guy brings transcends all religious language and gets to the heart of the whole awareness thing. And then you've got this chap who I see every couple of months. He comes to London to give a talk. Rupert Spira, and again hinting to the same thing, but he's one chap I've come across. Of all the different people I've met, he's one chap I've come across who is able to rationalize that experience in scientific ways. So Sufism, a foreign import at the heart of Islam, so many challenge it, so many questions say it's not actually original Islam, it's something that came later. Well, I beg to differ. So, what I hold is that when Muhammad had his experience in the cave, and he was meditating, what he was experiencing was, through that deep meditation, was that infinite consciousness. What these mystics refer to as Allah. Not a deity sitting up somewhere. So, what I want to just very quickly do is give an alternative kind of meaning to these various different words. So, years ago, when I started my journey on the Sikh studies, I was looking at the way Sikhs were, and I was thinking, they're all initiated, they're dressed up in certain ways, but boy, some of them are arrogant. And they're supposed to be true Sikhs. And you go to the Gurdwara, very, very much like the mosque situation, and you know, the hanky falls off slightly, you get told off. Get over it. I think the Guru's pretty chill, to be honest, sitting there, you know, in the form of a text. But these guys seem to get really worked up about it. And then as I'm looking through the text, I realised that these guys might be Sikhs, capital S, and it's what I've addressed in my thesis, capital S, but they're not Sikhs with a little s, which is a disciple. That's all it is. And actually, I think this is the crux of the issue with Islam as well. So Islam means submission. One who submits oneself, the ego, and unifies oneself in that oneness. If you put it as a capital I, then it's an institution. And it's a very different picture. So if you have a verse like from Surah Al-Imran, which says, if anybody desires a religion other than Islam, never shall it be accepted, and he shall be one of the losers in hereafter. Well, let's change that. If anybody desires a deen, and you know that's got enough of its issues of translation, other than submission, never shall it be accepted. So if you're going to bring your ego into the situation, then you're not going to get accepted. A Muslim is one who submits. So there's a guy I used to know, an Iraqi Jew, his language is Arabic. He said, I submit to, he said, I'm a Jewish Muslim. Okay? This way, no, he said, I'm not a capital M. Now, Allah, is it a contraction of Allah, or the God, or Allah, the hidden one? Okay? Which is what consciousness is. Ironically, it's not, because it's the very thing that you are. Tawheed, unity. Now, unity of God in a monotheistic sense or in a monistic sense? Absolute unity. Shirk. Association. It's an interesting one, this, because Sufis are obviously, often considered to engage in shirk when they identify the manifest universe with Allah. But then you've got two realities there. Whereas if there is only Allah, then we've got a different picture. And in fact, one of the Sufi translations often suggests there is no reality but reality, capital R. There is no God, only Allah. So not but Allah, but only Allah. So in fact, one of the Sufi authors I've been reading, he said he doesn't treat Allah as God. He says he's more than God. God's merely just a deity. That's a limitation, that's a relative thing. Because there's a duality there. But if there's only this being, then it's absolute. Gafir, one who conceals. Okay. One who conceals, so one who conceals the truth from their heart. It's not about belief systems. It's about transcendence of belief systems. Shaitan means an adversary. We've got so many adversaries within. So the inquiry that perennially has been there is the nature of awareness, the witnessing subject, what all teachers have been going on about. And what I like about this whole idea is that Sam, as one individual, doesn't like religion, but this is why I think he's different to the other two that I mentioned earlier, is that he holds mysticism as having value, and he's spent time experiencing, many years he's spent experiencing that stuff, what mystics would experience. So he doesn't dismiss it, and he's a neuroscientist. So he knows what's going on from an outside perspective and from an inside perspective. So, taking this perspective, how does it solve these problems? Well, these things disappear because you have much more of a unifying, loving approach. That's not a contradiction. Okay, Rupert Spira engages with this, as I mentioned earlier on. These guys, well, let science and history be dealt with the scientists and historians. Why are you trying to mix them up? The Quran is not dealing with those external things, I feel. I feel they're metaphors. It's talking about the inner experience of infinite awareness, which we call Allah. And, well, that experience is beyond language, so we don't need to get caught up in his problems. So, I'll end with a little one-liner. Which I can't find, but I remember it. then it goes, wisdom is knowing that we are one, love is what it feels like, and compassion is how it acts. I think if we take that approach and read the Quran through those, through that sort of lens, through those hermeneutics, I think we're going to get a different picture, and it becomes perennially relevant then.
Thank you very much, Rishi. That was very interesting. I'm really mindful of the fact that we did start late. So what I propose is.